Azt nem mondtuk el, hogy az előadókkal lehet majd beszélgetni, a szünetben lesz rá időtök, és erre is kérünk titeket, hogy tegyétek meg ezt, ami kérdés most felvetődik nyugodtan közben. Péter beszélt sokat hibázásról, ti sokat foglalkoztatok előtte, vagy valamennyit a dicsérettel, és most olyas valaki következik majd, aki az erőfeszítésre helyezne egy kicsit nagyobb hangsúlyt, azt hiszem, bár mindig mindenben minden benne van. Tegye fel a kezét, aki hallott már a WordPress fotókiállításról, vagy látta is azt. Wow, szuper, köszönöm. Na, az az ember következik most, akinek ezt köszönhetjük. Őt úgy hívják, hogy Révész Tamás, Balázs Béla díjas fotóművész, és ő fogja felvezetni a következő vendégünket. Tamás, parancsolj.
Jó reggelt kívánok! Egy barátomat szeretnék bemutatni önöknek. 1988-ban voltam először a WordPress Otto nemzetközi zsűriének tagja. A díjkiosztó ünnepség után egy parti volt, és valaki későn érkezett. Hihetetlen szeretettel fogadták, olyanok, mint a Time magazin, meg a Stern magazin képszerkesztői, és én ott zöldfölükként azt kérdezgettem, kicsoda ez a pasi. Kiderült, hogy ő Robert Pledge, egy francia-angol szülők gyermeke, újságíró, Afrika specialista. Később a Gamma ügynökség igazgatója lett, könyvei jelentek meg, díjakat kapott, nagyon komoly újságíró szervezeteknek elnöke, tanácsadója lett. 1976-ban megalakított egy ügynökséget, a Contact Press Images nevű ügynökséget New Yorkban, amely tulajdonképpen a Life magazin már-már alig létező hagyományait követve olyan fontos társadalmi kérdéseket és emberi jogokat feltáró képriportokra specializálódott, amire igazából nem is nagyon volt igény. Elképesztő társaságot hozott maga köré, olyanokkal dolgozott, mint csak, vagy néhány nevet említsek, akik talán ismertek Magyarországon, mint Annie Leibovitz, Don McCallin, Sebastian Salgado. Hogy mennyire nem ismertek kompromisszumot, az például nagyon jól illusztrálja egy eset. David Burnett volt az egyik társalapítója ennek az ügynökségnek, és egy kambodzsai menekült ügyről készített egy képriportot, amiről a Time magazin természetesen riportot akart közölni. Azonban a minőség érdekében ez a fotoriporter úgynevezett Kodakrom diapozitívra dolgozott, aminek a hívási ideje minimum két nap, mert a világon csak néhány városban lehetett előhívni. Nem is jelent meg a kép, azonban 1980-ban az évképe díjat nyerte el a WordPress Otto kiállításon, a pályázaton. Én már néhány éve az Egyesült Államokban éltem, amikor a 2002-ben fölkerestem Robert Pledge-et egy ötlettel, hogy szeretnék csinálni egy mesterkurzust a volt szocialista országok riporterei számára, és hogy lenne ő az egyik előadó. És akkor elkezdett kérdezősködni, hogy hogy képzelem ezt az egészet. Mondtam, hogy hát megszervezen a pályázatot interneten keresztül, lesz egy zsűri majd, a válogató zsűri az International Center of Photography-ban New Yorkban. Meghívom a New York Times egyik képszerkesztőjét, a School of Visual Arts egyik tanárát, a magyar Kornis Pétert, és hát természetesen mi ketten lennénk még tanárok. És hogy képzelem ezt az egészet? Hogy ki fogja ezt szponzorálni? Erre mondtam, hogy hát írtam már néhány levelet. És hogy fogom én ezt az interneten megoldani? Mondtam, hogy már járok egy website építő tanfolyamra. Tényleg nagyon vicces volt. Tudnak-e ezek a tanárok, ezek a leendő előadók erről az egész eseményről? Mondtam, hogy nem, veled kezdtem. Szóval az volt a helyzet, hogy ilyenkor legtöbbször azt mondják, hogy ugye good luck, amit nem szívesen fordítanék most le ebben a relációban. Azonban ő azt mondta egy kis idő után, hogy tudod mit, ha összejön, rendben van. 2004-ben mindannyian Budapesten voltunk egy hétre, az összes pályázó diák, akik elnyerték ezt a programot, megjelent egy könyv erről az anyagról, és kiáltás volt itt Budapesten, meg később Amerikában. Pledge nem ismer lehetetlen. Tényleg a neve, ha lefordítom, fogadalom, és annyira igaz a neve az ő személyiségéhez. Amikor meghallotta, hogy egy kínai fotográfus a kulturális forradalom idején minden kockát, minden tekercséből egy-két kockát elrejtette a parkettája alá, miközben az újság titkosan kezelt minden megjelent anyagot, és nagyon szigorúan archivált mindent, akkor azonnal Kínába utazott, és attól kezdve éveken át járt oda, hogy ebből egy könyv és kiállítás legyen. Meg is született természetesen. Nem ismerek mást, aki nagyobb tisztelettet érdemel, vagy nyert el a szakmában, mint ő. Talán még egy ember tudok mondani, John Morris, aki mellesleg nagyon jó barátja volt neki hosszú időn keresztül, akit viszont már nem lehet meghívni, mert 2 évvel ezelőtt, 101 éves korában elhunyt. Szóval fogadják Robert Pledge-et szeretettel, csak ezért jött Budapestre, hogy részt vegyen ezen a Heroikon konferencián. Köszönöm.
Thank you, sir. That was okay. Great. Good morning, everybody. I'm sorry I do not speak Magyar, so you'll have to deal with my English. I must say it's great to be introduced by somebody, a friend, who says all these, I suppose, nice things about you, and you don't know what they are. It's a great introduction. I'm very happy to be here, and I'm not quite sure why I am here, but I am. And I'm not quite sure what I'm going to say, but I'm going to say it anyhow. I'm involved in photography, but I didn't want to be involved in photography. That was an accident, by chance, a mistake, whatever. I wanted to be a doctor when I was a kid. That was my idea. I wanted to be able to help people who were in pain. I'm a child of World War II. I was born in the middle of the war, and of course, like people of my generation, I was shaped by war. And it's something at an early stage that was on my mind. So I never became a doctor. I became a journalist, and I met photographers, and I realized that they were using a language that was so powerful, so austere, so limited, that they were in the mode of silence. Photography is an art of silence, as my very dear friend, the mime Marcel Marceau, always told me. He was a mime, so he didn't speak. And he loved photography because he said that, in visual terms, photography was like mime. It said a lot without any noise. Photography is flat, square, rectangular. You can touch it, but there's no depth to it. It's flat. And that's how I got started and wanted to work with people who were photographers. I never took a picture in my life. I mean, I might have taken 10 or 12 photographs, but I don't take pictures, I don't carry a camera, I'm too lazy, I don't want to carry stuff. But I love what you can say with it. So, in New York in the early 70s, I regrouped a small bunch of people who were roughly my age or a little younger, and who had the same interest in the world, the same curiosity, the same desire to understand what our world was about, and who would go and travel. And for me, who always wanted to travel, to see the world everywhere, in many places, at any given time, through photography and through photographers, I was able to do that. So I'm going to show you photographs. I'm not doing justice to the photographers because, in a way, I'm only showing you the tip of the tip of the tip of the iceberg of the tremendous work that each one of them has done. There are a dozen photographers, six women, six men of different generations who have traveled to, and we'll see through the pictures, to about 50, 60 countries in the world. And in a little over 100 pictures, I'm going to give you a sense of some aspects of the world over the last five or six decades through the stories that they did. And my job was help to make these impossible stories become possible. Impossible because of access, because of resources, because of giving a shape to them. So let's get started, if you don't mind, then look at the pictures. And we will start with something that's very important that will be commemorated in 2 days from now, the fall of the Berlin Wall in 1989. A young photographer, Alexandra Avakian, was there 28 years after another photographer, Don McCullin, a very famous British photographer known as a war photographer, who was just knighted by the Queen recently, was there. And he, like her, at the same age approximately, decided to go to Berlin because they understood something was happening. Nobody sent them there. They went there out of their own curiosity, on their own initiative. They went there. And I'm just showing you these images in alternates, black and white by the British photographer, color by Alexandra Avakian, that show us what happened in those 28 years. That and of course, when I look at these pictures, and I've looked at them 1,000 times, and they always intrigue me. I always, even today, want to know, who are these people? Who is this woman looking out the window? Who is this woman who's peeping through the wall? Who are these soldiers who are there? What has become of them? And I think that has been the guiding energy behind everything we've done. Don McCullin today is 84 years old. Alexandra Avakian is surviving cancer battle right now, and she's only in her late 50s. There are 20, 30 years in it. She was born, actually, the year before the wall went up. But my interest, as I said, also started with World War II, during which I was born in London. I was born in London of a French mother, English father, and I came to meet, much later on, a man called John Morris, who was a picture editor at Life magazine in London, in charge of covering the war on the Western Front. He was not a photographer, he was an editor. But shortly after D-Day, after Normandy, the landing in Normandy on June 6, 1944, he wanted to go and see for himself what was happening over there. He had no obligation to. He managed to convince his editors to send them there. The battles were going on in Normandy and Brittany. And for the first time in his life, he took a camera, a square format camera, and he took a few pictures over the 3.5 weeks he was over there. In 3.5 weeks, he shot 14 rolls of film, which is 168 images. Today, in the digital world, you shoot 168 images in about 1.5 minutes. He needed 3.5 weeks to do that. He took these as notes. And when I saw the pictures just a few years ago and discovered them, I was so amazed at this that I told him that there was a book. He should do a book. We should do a book. He thought he was not a photographer. And I convinced him, and I made possible this reportage that he did 69 years earlier to become a book. That was very successful. And actually, there was an exhibition that was presented in Budapest at the Robert Capa Photography Center a few years ago. Fortunately, he discovered the 9 letters he wrote to his wife during that period of time that had gone through censorship, military censorship. And I got those letters, and with interviews of him and his photographs, we put together a book that was his book, his voice, his images, his words. Speaking of photographers, he died just a few years ago at the age of 100, almost 101. Catherine Leroy died before he did, and she was only 60 years old. She was an incredible petite woman, 5 feet tall, 85 pounds, and at the age of 21, she bought a Leica camera that she didn't know how to use, a one-way ticket to Saigon in Vietnam, and with $150 in her pocket, went to cover that war that was going on. She wanted to know what this war was about. And she became one of the bravest and most extraordinary war photographers of the Vietnam War. Everybody has forgotten her. Nobody remembers her because she was the only woman photographer in 1966, 67, 68, during the fiercest battles of Vietnam War. And of course, she was very humble and got lost, and all the big guys became very famous, the Larry Bars, the Don McCullin, but not her. We have discovered her work, and we're putting it together. I knew her personally, and I chose to put that work together. And it's going to be published next year. There are 3 books that are being done on her. There's 1 documentary film, and she's going to be discovered, rediscovered, or really discovered, this extraordinary woman who had no fear, and who, after her experience in Vietnam, would become a fierce anti-war activist, exactly like John Morris, whose pictures of 1944 we saw earlier. They have this in common. They also have in common that she wrote, during her 3 years in Vietnam, over 100 letters to her mother and father, where she explained what was going on. She never said the truth. She didn't want to scare them, but she wrote these amazing letters. And we're putting the letters, like we did with John Morris, together with her pictures, so it will be her voice, it will be her book. And this is an extraordinary document. The picture you're seeing now is of that medic who was on the top of the hill taking care of a wounded Marine, and this picture was taken 40 years later, a year before she herself died. So I'm fascinated with these characters, these photographers who have these amazing insights, like this Chinese photographer, Li Jiancheng, who I happened to meet in 1988 in China, and who told me that he wanted to do a book and maybe I could help him to do that. And I said, well, maybe I can help, but you know, what did you do that's so special? And he told me that he was a newspaper photographer, therefore part of the propaganda machine in China, but he photographed pictures of his that he thought were important during the Cultural Revolution. He also did self-portraits, which was totally unusual. Here is a picture of him taking a bath for the first time in his life. It was such an important event he photographed. But he photographed the Cultural Revolution that tore apart China for 10 years. And he kept his negatives and his pictures in little brown envelopes like the one you see right now. He kept them and he buried them because he knew that they were not politically correct. He kept on doing self-portraits, and he documented what was going on, and he documented as a propaganda photographer, but he documented also as an underground photographer, using an armband of the Red Guards as a sort of accreditation, and attending all these events that were very often very terrible, where political leaders were publicly humiliated, had their hair cut, were mistreated, and had to make public confessions day after day, and sometimes up to 2,000 or 3,000 times over a year or two. So he photographed all these, and he cut out the film that he would process himself. He would never let anybody else do it. He cut out that film, and he would bury his negative negatives so nobody could see them, and he kept them under the floorboard of his apartment. And for 10 years, he did this. He was actually at one stage sent to re-education himself because he was not a very disciplined character. But he has accumulated one of the most extraordinary bodies of work on that period of time, a 12-year period of time. And we did a book together. Finally, when he told me what it was about, I said, I will help you. I would help you, but I want to see everything. He said, everything? I've got 60,000 negatives. I said, well, if you can reduce it in half because there's duplication, I will look at the 30,000. I looked at 30,000, including the pictures he retouched for political reasons that he had to retouch. And from the 30,000, I extracted 300 pictures to do a book and 150 to do an exhibition. It took us 3.5 years to do that. And he did these panoramic images using 2 or 3 images because he didn't have a panoramic camera. And he did everything himself by hand. So war and conflict was always something I had interest, maybe because I was born out of there. And I happened to be in New York when 9/11 happened. I was leaving New York for Paris on the 10th, and in the last minute canceled my trip and was there when the Twin Towers were attacked. And several photographers, including Loy Grinker, went down there. She was sick, and she went on foot from Brooklyn all the way to Ground Zero and did remarkable work. She was working on a project that took her 12 years to develop on the veterans of the wars of the 20th century, from the Great War of 1914-18 to the recent wars, well, all the way up to actually the World Trade Center, and photographed people. It took her so long because she did extensive interviews in many languages with translators, and it took horrendous amount of time to translate that, but to find the money, the resources, the translators to do that. And my job as an editor, as a curator, a guide, is to help photographers who have that kind of energy and that kind of talent to make things happen. And she visited 40 countries in the world, interviewed 100 or more people in their own language that she didn't speak, but with translators. Everything was translated, put together, and it ended up being a book. Most of these projects become a book that not that many people see or read, but that is a trace, something solid. All these photographers get published in magazines. They've all been recognized and received awards from the World Press Photo, etc. But the important thing is that trace, is that book that will stay and that will be their testimony. So I'm showing here a number of photographers, only a limited number of photographers' work, and only one project that they worked on. But they work with great intensity. They are avid to discover. This is actually the cover of the book. You saw the picture. The other side of the picture is the back of the book. We try never to crop the pictures. We never cut the pictures. We leave them as such. Adriana Groisman was a student of mine at the International Center of Photography in New York many years ago. She's Argentinian, and she was intrigued by this war that happened in the the Malvinas, the Malouin Islands, in near Argentina. And she was hired by the National Geographic to be a translator for a group of people who were doing research on a ship that had been sunk and where 320 Argentinian soldiers died because of a British torpedo. And she was so intrigued by the whole story that she decided to go to the Falkland Islands and to see what this battle was about. But she was going after the fact. It was very difficult for an Argentinian woman, furthermore, to go to a British island in the south part of the world, but she managed to do that at her own cost. We had to find ways of getting money, grants, and to make it happen. And it took her 14 years of work to finally put a book together, where she did amazing work of gathering interviews, speaking to people, British and Argentinian, who had fought the war, and revisiting the sites and finding the traces of the conflict. A bit of an airplane here, a shoe there, something, and the traces of the bombing, the whole situation. And she finally also was able to convince British and Argentinian soldiers, officers, etc., to speak to her. It took her many years before they accepted to be interviewed. And she got them to meet each other, and she paired them together. They became friends, and she had them sew their pictures that she took of them, the portraits, together to show that they had overcome this terrible enmity, hostility that had once brought them face to face in combat. So she was not only reporting, doing the interviews, but also giving a more permanent expression, artistic expression, to her work. David Burnett, who founded the agency I set up in New York in 1970-something, I don't remember, it so long ago, was the only American photographer who had the courage to go to Iran at the time of the changes that took place there in 1979, when the Shah of Iran was overthrown and the Ayatollah Khomeini took over. He was the only American, Jewish American, furthermore, and because he spoke French well, he managed to convince everybody he was Canadian and French-Canadian. And he worked there, and he spent 44 days covering that amazing transformation, political and otherwise transformation of Iran, that led to the Iran of today. And he was all over the place, working in color and in black and white. And we ended up 30 years later doing a book with his words, with his photographs, with also a lot of research and trying to keep a historical record of the entire event, that entire period of 44 days that he was present there. His pictures are very powerful. You're just seeing a few of them here. He was totally engaged. He is one of these exceptional photographers who graduated in political science, who originally was not going to become a photographer, like most of these people were not planning to be photographers, but they realized that photography was such an extraordinary, powerful tool, this flat, silent form of expression. Can say so much. And actually, I'm going to be sure, he was the only photographer who got to meet the Ayatollah Khomeini. He got there by perseverance and patience. This is what is so extraordinary, is that in a very short period of time, I can take you around the world and tell you so many things just from 100 or something photographs, which you can do with no other medium. Film would take you hours to look at all this. Here is somebody I want to speak to who's been very present, Shaidul Alam, who is going to have a major exhibition in New York at the end of this week, and why I have to go back to New York, and who was in prison for over 107 days for reporting things that were happening in Bangladesh, where he is from. He was a PhD in chemistry and discovered photography and decided to go back and document what was happening in his own country. And he has become a real voice, probably the only strong voice of opposition. A photographer is a voice, which is strange for most people. And he's an activist. He uses photography in a very powerful way. He works in Bangladesh. He publishes. He's developed a festival of photography after having started a school to train photographers. And now he has developed a university program in journalism related to photography. He's an extraordinary individual. And that's why he was put in prison, of course, because he had reported on the violence of police against students who were protesting, the big number of accidents in which students were killed by drivers in the streets of Bangladesh. He's documented all these various movements in Bangladesh. Here, a woman protesting against violence against women in Bangladesh, a student arrested and for some other protest, killings that take place, extrajudicial killings by undercover police against the opposition to the government by the thousands. And he is the only voice of opposition really in his own country. This picture we're seeing now was taken in 1981, and it's a picture of peace, and one of the few photographs of such in his own country. But it's not only war and conflict, or it's also about internal conflicts. Jane Evelyn Atwood is an American photographer who lives in Paris and has lived, and now she's a French citizen, and who's always photographs these worlds that are impossible to get access to, the world of prostitution, the world of prisons, and women's prisons. It's the access to these places was incredibly difficult. I helped her in a number of places to get that kind of access. It started in France, and which had never happened. They had never allowed photographers into a prison to spend time. And she wanted to live in the prison, so she asked to be locked up in a cell for a week and to stay there, not to go to the hotel and come back and forth. She was so determined. Nobody was backing her. It was her project. Then I helped her to get to Russia, and these are the photographs we're seeing. It was still the Soviet Union or the end of the Soviet Union, and I had friends who were journalists and helped to make this happen. And she spent time in a variety of places around the world, in Czechoslovakia, like here, documenting, like it never had been done before, the world of incarceration for women. And the numbers are staggering, and the reason for which these women are there are also quite extraordinary. These are images now from prisons in the United States. So all these photographers have a sort of mission. They have, and there's a passion to document, to inform, to discover, then to make public, to say, to explain what is going on. Most of the images we see every day in our lives in the streets of every city are advertising, propaganda, nice pictures of newspaper, on television, happy events. There's very little of this kind of material. But this is so powerful. These flat, square, or rectangular images have so much power. And this is what is common to all these photographers and to myself. in getting involved in this world of photography. Frank Fournier is a French photographer who I woke up one day at 4 o'clock in the morning because a friend of mine called and said, there's been this volcano eruption in Colombia, you should send somebody over. So I called him up at 6 o'clock, he was on a plane. 4 hours later, he was in Colombia, and there had been this earthquake that killed 23 or 25,000 people, and there were a few survivors. And one of the people he came across was this little girl, Omara Sanchez, 13 years old, who was stuck in the debris, and there was no way she could be saved. And he knew it. He had been a medical student for 4 years before he decided to quit medicine and become a photographer. And he decided to stay with her and photographed her so that she would never be forgotten and document her slow agony. He knew she would not survive because of his medical background. He looked at her and he knew there was nothing she could be done. She was trapped in the debris of this volcano. It was a horrendous story. The picture got much recognition all over the world, but Frank Fournier was accused of being a mercenary, a pirate, somebody was terrible who photographed this poor little girl to make money. And that was not what it was about. And these pictures today are so, so important and so powerful. And the only trace of the existence of this incredible 9-year-old girl, I said 13, she was 9 years old, and she died. And the people who were helping were shattered. She was one of the only survivors, or few survivors, and she ended up dying. And now I want to show you something else, that not only human beings, but sometimes animals are more kind than human beings. And it's the story of this incredible gorilla who saved the life of a child in the zoo where she was living and carrying her baby child on her tummy. And this little boy fell into the gorilla's den. And the male gorillas came and felt very threatened by this object from out of space and wanted to. And this gorilla pushed them aside and picked up this little child and carried this little child through the whole den and dropped this child in front of the gate where the zookeepers would come and bring food, and left the child there to be saved by the zookeepers. This gorilla was so extraordinary. Her name is Bintijwa. Today there's a plaque in the Chicago Zoo where this happened to honor her because she has done something quite extraordinary. She carried this little child through this huge gorilla den, and you'll see, dropped her off there. This is an extraordinary situation where sometimes you realize that animals are much more kind and generous than human beings are, unfortunately. So Robert Allison, who took this picture, was an amateur photographer. He was a carpenter, didn't have money, and he took his children to the zoo as their summer vacation, one day at the zoo. But when he saw what happened, he reacted, and this is his contact sheet from which all the images come from, and he told that whole story in a few minutes, moving around the area where the child fell. And it's an extraordinary reportage, and I thought I would end my presentation with this remarkable gorilla, Bintijwa, whose name you should never forget. We don't know the name of the child. He is anonymous. There was an arrangement between the family of the child and the zoo to keep it secret. The zoo paid money so that the family would not sue the zoo, etc. And we've been trying to find this child ever since. We will find him one day. Thank you very much.